Good evening. Here we are, final weekend. Glad to be here with you. As we worship together here tonight, let us remember that the heavenly music that we are talking about in Revelation is something we're going to experience ourselves very soon. And so this program tonight is focused on how Jesus is the one who holds life in his hands. And in light of things that have happened more recently than the Roseburg shootings, even death has an answer in Christ. And so we're going to find tonight the hope that he offers in life after death. We're going to begin with our theme song. It'll be up on the screen. Feel free to sing along. You should know it by now. Father in heaven, as we come to you tonight, we recognize how you sent Jesus Christ in human flesh, lived that perfect life, died the death that we deserved, and yet he is risen, and with him he took the keys of death and hell. He can open up things that no one can shut. And so, Lord, we're thankful for the open door of everlasting life you give to us. Guide us to see Jesus in this topic here tonight. In his name we pray. Amen. There I was at Umpqua Community College in Roseburg, Oregon, back in 1999 to 2000 school year. And as I was going to school there, I was studying hotel restaurant management, was planning to become a full-time cook. that type of thing. I had been part-time before. And it was an interesting experience there because at Umpqua Community College, there's many different ages of people who go to school there. They think it's mostly just young people that got shot up there, but as you look at it, there are people who are second career, there are people who are stay-at-home moms or going back to school. There are the ones that were younger like me who were just going from high school to college. And that's one of these individuals that I met on a bench sitting there at Umpqua Community College waiting for the bus. As I would sit there periodically waiting for the bus, this individual, it just seemed like he kept bumping into me, or I kept bumping into him. It was either waiting for the bus or on our way to and from classes or over at the lunchroom or on the bus itself. And when he met with me one of the last times I talked to him, he said to me, "If God were real," self-proclaimed atheist, "if God were real, he'd know that I'm hungry right now and he'd give me some food." And so we're sitting there, and I just put my math book away into my bag, and I noticed there's an apple in there as he's saying this, and so I pull out the apple and I hand it to him. So he acts momentarily surprised, and then puts on his mask again, and he says, "You can't tell me there's a God in this world." And you know, he's argued with me over and over again. And we've built a relationship of mutual disagreement, and as I'm there respectfully disagreeing with him at times, I asked some pointed questions, and this is what happened this time. I asked him some pointed questions, and I said, "So what are your plans after college?" Not really that pointed, right? But it's going to go there. And he's like, "Well, I'm going to go ahead and go on get my bachelor's degree at OSU. I'm going to go on to get a master's and a doctorate from it in science, and that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be a professor of science and research." And he had this whole map of his life laid out in front of him there. And I said, "Well, after you have a good career, then what?" "Well, I might get a wife and kids, you know, whatever. part of the evolutionary cycle. But anyway, get a wife and kids, and I'll raise them, put them through college, and eventually I'll retire, and we'll travel the country." And that's where it ended. That's where his map ended. Because after he's old and traveling the country, well, to him, that's like the end game. And I said, "Well, what then? After you retire and you're in a nursing home and they're pumping you full of fluids and different things to keep you alive and you're dying, what then?" And I had enough rapport in the relationship to push the guy to that point. And he was even more quiet at that point than when he reached the end of his roadmap with retirement. He had no answer. You know, and as we look at our world today, to him, death was the end. That was it. Once he retires, gets into old age, somehow his mind goes into oblivion, he goes into the grave, perishes, that's it. That's an atheistic belief. That's what he told me. I guess that's it. That's the end of me. And I proceeded to share with him briefly some words of hope that I found, to which, at the end of it, he said, "That's interesting." That's all he said. I don't know what he did with it. I don't know if he put it on a shelf and later took it off and used it. But as I think of this topic of death, I go to the book Revelation. And Revelation, as far as us as Christians, it mentions, that Jesus was the one who lives, was dead, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. Jesus himself says this in Revelation. And yes, there are lots of different views about death. In fact, there are seminars that you can go to that will cost you a lot of money to go to talk to people on the other side. In fact, there's matinees in UK and all that, where they will bring back your dead dogs and things on a Saturday afternoon, and you can pet your dog and all of that for a fee. So there are lots of views of life after death, including the atheistic view. And as a Christian, though, as you're asking me about Revelation, because that's what this seminar is about, I'm going to go to the words of Jesus to talk to you about this. And the reason why this is important is because when we get to the rapture tomorrow morning, we're going to see this puzzle piece fits in perfectly with the Bible view of the rapture. And so Revelation says Jesus lives, he's alive, he was dead, he's alive forevermore, and it goes on, and it says, Jesus says, "I have the keys of Hades and of death." So anybody who gets somewhat close to the Bible view of life after death has been given that wisdom by Jesus himself. I don't care if it's philosophy, I don't care how they reasoned it out and figured it out. If they somehow get anywhere close to what we discover here, then it's not from human wisdom, it's actually from the one who says, I hold the keys of Hades and of death. So if I look at Jesus' words carefully, and I just meditate upon them, that means he knows exactly what happens. And if he has the keys of Hades and death, then he knows exactly what happens after the grave. And so I'm going to go to the words of Jesus for my topic here tonight. And we know this story, some of us do. It's talking about Lazarus, and word comes to Jesus that Lazarus is sick, and pretty much Jesus says, well, he's asleep. And as you look in John chapter 11, verse 11 through 14, it says, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up. He's delayed going to Lazarus because Lazarus has been in sick condition. We find he eventually decides to go to Lazarus, and he says, I'm going to go wake him up. And they're thinking, well, if he's sick and he's asleep, then just pretty much leave him alone. And his disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get well. So basically, he already put it off, and if he's asleep, he'll get well. However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought that he was speaking about taking rest in sleep. So as we're looking at the words of Jesus, and he's the one who holds the keys of Hades and of death, or of death and hell, we find then that he, his own words, describes death as like taking a sleep, resting in sleep. And so that's a pretty important piece of the puzzle. And as I'm looking at this, I use an old method, really not that old. It's been around ever since ranchers put fence posts up. You find that, you have your fence posts, you want to line them up in a certain direction. Well, you could put one fence post in the ground and you could go any direction from that, couldn't you? But as I read the scriptures, I'm thinking to myself, I'm looking at the words of Jesus first in the Gospels, because John doesn't say a whole lot about hell other than a brief period in Revelation 19, 20, and 21. So I'm going to be looking outside of that book at other words of John, which John wrote these. I'm going to look at the words of Jesus because he holds the keys. And I'm going to put them all together so that I don't just have one post and you could go one direction and say, well, I go on the ground like an atheist and that's it. Or you could be like the others, some of the others who believe that you're some disembodied spirit who can come back and communicate, or even come back in a puppy dog state or something like that, or you come back looking like the loved one. So there's a lot of different views out there. And I'm going to put one post in the ground and say, I know Jesus has the answer, and then I'm going to put another one in and another one. I'm going to let Scripture begin to lead me in a certain direction. It may be different, and I will guarantee you, when I first discovered this, it was different than anything I had ever known before. I had a picture of death that is contrary to what I'm going to describe to you here tonight. A picture of death that was very fearful. And actually, this takes away not the fear necessarily of dying and going into some kind of unconscious state, but it takes away the hopelessness. And so we find Jesus talking about death as a sleep, and we find in John chapter 11, verse 11 through 14, then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. So to Jesus himself, it's like a sleep. And some say, well, that's soul sleep, right? Well, we'll get to that a little bit later. But as you look at this, Jesus' own words, if we were just to stop here and have a commentary from Jesus on death, he would tell you it's like a sleep. That's really all you need to know tonight. If you were to die on your way back to your home tonight, it would be like a sleep. Now, as far as how you wake up on the other side of that, that depends upon your relationship with Jesus. If you wake up on the side of it with Jesus, then it's more hopeful than if you don't. And so Jesus said to her, as you go on down through the text, we find he eventually goes and finds Mary and Martha, and he talks to them and mentions, your brother will rise again. And Jesus begins to explain to Martha, in essence, yes, he's dead. Yes, it's a very discouraging situation. You find Jesus weeps eventually over it, but he is the author of life. That's the direction that he's going with this. So regardless of what we feel is the view of this, Jesus is the one who knows, and he is giving them assurance in this text. And so Martha herself believed something about death. She said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection. When? At the last day. Do you know this is not the only view in Israel at the time? We're going to find a little later in the sermon tonight that there were some people in Israel who believed a Greek version of death, life after death. So to have someone like Martha come to Jesus with this viewpoint, when even in her own day there were rabbis and teachers who taught something different, that means she's been a follower of Jesus. That means that she knows him, she knows he's the resurrection, she knows he's the life, and she recognizes there's a resurrection at the last day. She's actually following patriarchs and prophets' beliefs from the Old Testament rather than the rabbis of her day. It's a totally opposite view than what some of them believed. Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Though he may sleep," you can interchange that word, "he will rise." And so we find him going to the tomb there, and we find the emotion does catch him there before that. He says, "Lazarus, come forth," right? And I'm not going to get into how come he didn't say come down or come up, you know, whatever. We find he comes forth. They unwrap him from the grave tombs. And so the resurrection of Lazarus is the proof that Jesus can raise our believing loved ones from the grave. Now we're going to find later on he can raise anybody from the grave. But especially if we're looking for hope for our loved ones, then it's found in Jesus. He's the one who has the keys. And it appears at his voice, the key turns. And the person who was dead, who shouldn't really have any recollection at that point, hears his voice and becomes alive again. And this scene with Lazarus was asleep, he was dead, and now all of a sudden he's alive. We'll find this scene repeated in the plan of salvation. What was done in the life of Lazarus on a small spirit is going to be happening in the plan of salvation for every true believer. And so death was asleep. The Bible teaches that death is like a sleep that lasts until Christ's second coming, that lasts until we will find his voice calls him forth. And we find in the Bible at least 50 times where the word sleep is attached to someone dying. So-and-so died and slept with his fathers. And we're not talking about immorality here. We're talking about death here. You go through the whole Old Testament, grab a concordance, you'll start looking up the word sleep, you'll find it's over and over again in the Old Testament. It's very clear. It happens over and over again in the Old Testament. For instance, in Psalm 13, verse 3, "Consider and hear me, O Lord my God, enlighten my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death." Some of them are so clear. Death is like a sleep. And so we find that's in Psalm 13. We go on to 1 Kings 2. "Now the days of David drew near." This is one of those ones where they were buried with their forefathers. "So David rested with his fathers and was buried in the city of David." Or some translations say he slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. So you find this idea of sleep or resting in the tomb is an Old Testament concept. And Jesus reaffirms it. Martha reaffirms it. And so we look at this concept of sleep. We find it also goes back to creation. Because you remember Adam was asleep. And then, in essence, he's asleep because God's forming him of the dust. He's awakened by his Creator, putting the breath of life in him. So we even go all the way back to Genesis. "Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Man became a living soul." And so from a sleep-like situation, from pretty much nothing, no consciousness, all of a sudden he's conscious with full life in him. The same thing happens with the formation of Eve. Adam goes to sleep. And what we find is when he wakes up, there she is, which means she didn't have any consciousness either because she came from his sleeping body. So you find the same concept with both Adam and Eve. So he becomes a living soul. Made of the dust of the ground, breath of life into him, he becomes a living soul. And so we have this old equation, dust plus the spirit equals a living soul. So what would happen if somehow our bodies died? We would subtract dust, we would then have the breath, but we would no longer have a living soul. You would not have a full equation there. And the same thing would happen as well as if you can't live without the breath of life anyway, but if it happened and all you were was body, you still would not be a living soul. So you can't live without the breath, and if your body's gone as well, you subtract any one of those and you're no longer a living soul. So if we go this way, elements of the earth plus the breath is a living being, some translations say. So living soul, living being, living person, same idea. So when we die, it's a reversal of that. We then sleep. So as I look at my idea of what life after death was, it was a fully conscious life after death in a lake of fire, because that's where I was at the time. This doesn't teach that. And out of all the evenings my grandfather read the Bible, I don't know why I didn't catch this. You know, he was reading through the whole Bible. And he mentioned sleep, and he got to Lazarus one time. I remember him reading it, but it never fully registered in my mind. I always thought that we were somehow immortal in and of ourselves, that we would just live forever beyond the grave, but the Bible doesn't teach that. Ezekiel says, "Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father as well as the soul of the Son is mine." Goes on, "The soul who sins shall die." It's talking about how the Father is not held accountable for the Son's sins, nor the Son for the Father's. It's not like it's somehow just because you sin means your sons are going to sin. And just because your son sinned doesn't mean it's just necessarily your fault. He's pointing that out. And he goes on and says, the one who sins, the soul that sins, will die. So we find this idea of a soul dying. And so another name for soul is a person or life. If you were to take that word soul, look it up in Bible Works, for instance. It's an advanced Bible software for the Old Testament and New. You would find it, there's a Greek Old Testament called the Septuagint, the LXX. You start looking at key words for soul, and it's psuche. Okay? We get the word psychology from this. And that word can mean life, you know, your living, breathing life, can mean your soul, or just you're talking about yourself. So however you take it, life, soul, self, we find goes into unconsciousness at death. That's why it says the person who sins in this version here is the one who will die. So today's English version actually gets it right. The person who sins is the one who will die. It gets rid of that whole mystical idea of some disembodied soul. So there's no such thing in the Bible as an immortal soul because God's the one who's immortal. The Bible uses the word soul 1,600 times, and I've counted some other ones where it's pretty much the word psuche, and it can be even more. And never once does it use the word or the words together, immortal soul. Immortal by itself, yes. Soul by itself, yes. The only one who has immortality is actually, we find, it's resident in Jesus. And Jesus uses that word life and soul as well. He says in Matthew 16, "For whoever desires to save his life," this is that word for soul in the Greek, "will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." So this is something that can be lost. A soul can be lost. And if we think of it as just somehow some disembodied spirit, then how come they're lost at death? So we're talking about your life ends at death. And there's a pause there. And he uses the word later on, he uses the same idea as you keep reading. "For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul?" So if you look back here in verse 25, life, and over here, soul. He's using the same idea interchangeably. So according to the words of Jesus, the Old Testament where he created people, it appears that he gives life that awakens us, and then when we die, death is a reversal of that, we go into a sleep-like state. And Jesus himself is the one who has immortality. "Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever." Who's the immortal one? The King eternal is immortal. He's the one who has immortality. And go on down to 1 Timothy 6:15-16. "He who is blessed and the only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, he dwells in unapproachable light." So it's clear from the text, Jesus is the author of life. He gave it to us. Then when sin came in, we no longer have life in and of ourselves anymore. We're still dependent upon God. We were dependent upon God in the first place with the tree of life, remember? So God has life. He offers it to us. And then as a result of sin, we separate from the life giver. And on our own, we don't have immortality. That's why Jesus came. If we believe something else, I was reasoning with myself this week. If I believe something else, that somehow I have life in and of myself without Jesus, then why did I need Jesus to die on the cross? It began to undermine the cross. That's very teaching. And it won't surprise you, the roots of this teaching. We'll look at it in a few moments. But it effectively undermines the cross. That's my biggest beef with the idea of having immortality in and of myself. I need Jesus for that. They needed the tree of life before for that. We need the tree where he's dying upon Calvary for life. And so Jesus alone has immortality. And we find God gave it to us at the beginning. We are the ones who decided to walk away from it. So when God created Adam, he placed his breath within him, not an immortal soul. So it's a life-giving ability, breath. You try to explain the miracle, it just totally starts fading into oblivion because you really can't explain it. He gives us life. That's the essence of it. And the breath is life, not a soul. And that's why it says, the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Man became a living soul. So then death, then, is a reversal of creation. That's what Satan endeavored to do, and that's exactly what happens at death. The other problem we have is if we accept the view that we're mortal in and of ourselves, then that means we've somehow partaken of the tree of life as sinners. And I don't know about you, but as I read Genesis, it appears they were escorted from the garden to prevent that from happening so they would not live forever. They could not live forever without God. So then Satan would be right. They could live forever without God. And then that whole scenario in Genesis begs the question, all right, who's telling the truth here? God or the serpent? Modern popular beliefs have the serpent telling the truth and God not knowing what he's talking about. And unfortunately, those modern views of death lead down a very dark path. And so we find the Bible tells us death is a creation in reverse, and that's why the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. The spirit, breath, life, will return to God. That's why in the Old Testament, the word for spirit is ruach, which means breath. And we find the spirit and soul or the breath can end because you're not immortal and neither am I without God. And so it doesn't mean that somehow you cease to exist when you die, because if Jesus holds the keys of death and hell, then he knows the essence of who you are. He's going to preserve who you are in him. You're in Jesus now. There's no fear in death. I don't know about you, but as I look at God's record and the way he's done things since the beginning of humanity down to the end, he's fair, he's just, he makes everything right, he honors the belief and faith of his followers. And so there is no fear that somehow if I go to sleep in Jesus and don't go there right away, there's no fear for me that somehow I'm going to be lost in the equation. I mean, he holds those keys. He unlocks the tombs. We have whole warehouses full of memory cloud systems that we all put our backup data on, right? And so we think somehow that God, the God of the universe, can't back up our human existence, the essence of who we are. And we can back up all kinds of stuff, and we probably because we want to be kind of like God. And so we think that we can do that. Why can't God, in his omnipotence and his all-knowingness, how come he can't do that himself? So we try to limit God too, that somehow we have to go right away, otherwise there could be a problem in the whole situation. It's an issue of trust, really. And when I was doing a meeting like this in Coffeeville, Kansas, there was somebody who was in the ego business, a real big baritone singer in his day, sang with Pavarotti, and the issue was trust. It wasn't the topic. It wasn't the Bible facts, because they're right there. It was the issue of, well, I've never heard that before. And deep down, he didn't know if he could trust God with that much of his existence. And it took a surrender for that to take place. And so I think deep down, that's really what this comes down to, is are we willing to surrender our very existence to God and say, you know what? No, I'm not in control after I die. You are. The Bible teaches that the breath and the spirit are the same thing. For instance, in Job, it says, all the while my breath is in me, the spirit of God is in my nostrils. So it's talking about breath and spirit in the same text here. And Job is pretty clear. He believes in a resurrection at the last day, which, by the way, is what Martha believed in. James 2 says, the body without the spirit or breath is dead. It has a whole lot more to say with faith and works. But as we're looking here, this concept is laced in their thinking as Jewish Christians, rightly understanding the Old Testament, they truly believed that the spirit and the body, or the breath and the body, were two components that made you a living soul. And when they were separated, then there was this thing called death. So what happens at death? It seems pretty clear. The spirit or breath of life, or the power of life, goes back to God. And then Of course, your body goes into the grave, and God makes a new one eventually. And since the power to create life is with God, His Spirit, which gave life, returns to Him, and the essence of who we are is never lost. Another question, though. At death, then, if it's called asleep, is there consciousness? Because, you know, I go to sleep, and sometimes I remember things that happen in the night, especially with four kids. There's a lot of things to remember in the night. And then the sheep start baying, and the livestock guardian dogs start running. And, you know, so there's a lot of things that go through my brain as I'm sleeping at night. But as you're looking at this concept in the Bible, in Psalm 146, His Spirit departs, He returns to His earth, and that very day His plans or His thoughts perish. So this is sleep in the purest sense. No interruptions. Just like that, you know, the next thing you know, it's morning, and you feel refreshed. I'm so tired right now. Some of my words aren't coming out right because of that, because of a lack of sleep. But as you look at this sleep called death, can you imagine believing in Jesus, going to sleep, maybe even worn out because the body needed a trade-in, right? And you go to sleep in Jesus, and you wake up, and you feel better than new. I mean, that's the kind of sleep we're talking about here. And so our thoughts will perish, our plans or thoughts will cease. For instance, it says in Ecclesiastes, the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing. It has a lot to say about this. And the problem with Ecclesiastes is some people seem to think that it's kind of like you can pick and choose in the Bible. And you look at Ecclesiastes, and you go over here, and they say to me, well, you know, I'm just not sure that that's really the way life after death is, the way Solomon was writing that. Hello, this is like the wisest guy on earth, and he's writing about it, and he's actually facing the prospect himself, and we're saying that he doesn't know anything about it. And it's like they wanted to sit there, and they want to go along, and they want to take one page of the Bible, Ecclesiastes, this one right here, and rip it out first, and then throw it away, and then come along later and rip another page out and throw it away and just keep doing that. Now, how much do we have left after that? That was a piece of paper, by the way. I just wanted you to have the sound there. As I put all of these together, it builds something. It builds something. It builds a consistent witness from the Scriptures. It says their love, their hatred, their envy have now perished. They have no more under the sun. So their thoughts cease, and so do mine at death. What about having something to do with the living after death? Well, as we look at that concept, if we were to believe that there was a conscious existence after death, then there could be somehow a conscious reaching out from the dead to us. And wherever I've done meetings like this, there's always someone who has a memory, recent or further back in the past, of someone from the dead talking to them. That happens. Even people who see this from the Bible, sometimes they tell me, you know, I heard my loved one trying to get my attention after they died, down the hallway. I heard his voice, and when I ignored it, he started yelling at me. Now, she knew her husband fairly well and knew that when he yelled, there was a certain tone. And anyway, so it seemed exactly like her husband yelling at her down the hall, aggravated because she would not choose to listen to that voice. We also have, in Africa, girls who, it's not just demons who come to their rooms, but it's actually demons in the disguise of ancestors, loved ones from the past. And they come into the girls' rooms, and the parents teach them that when a relative from the past comes into your room, you are to allow them to come into you. And that's how we get demon possession, not just harassment, but demon possession of some of these girls in Africa. Those were three of the girls when I was presenting this type of topic in Africa years ago. They came to me, how do we get them to leave? And it was more than just one of them coming to the room. Multiples. And I told them what to say. He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. So tell them in the name of Jesus to leave. And they did that. And we didn't have any problem at my meetings. But down the road, where my friend was doing his meetings, one of the girls did not have that particular victory. And at the baptism, you can see the video clip. There she is, flipping out, frothing at the mouth, and they take her aside, and they find out exactly what happens. She's fading in and out of craziness, really, and she tells them what happened, this being in her room. So what do? They pray over this girl. Next thing you see on the video clip is them taking her back into the water, and she's perfectly fine, peaceful. And they take her down and out, and she's raising her hands and praising the Lord. So what was that thing that had taken possession of her? It was a loved one. And so as we look at this, the dead have nothing more to do with us after the grave. There's only a select few we find in the Bible who have had something to do with us after the grave. For instance, Moses and Elijah appeared to Jesus. Enoch, we find, walked with God. Elijah, we know, we went up to heaven. We also find 24 elders in Revelation, which we'll talk about a little bit later when we talk about Jesus. And so Job is clear. If his sons are honored, he does not know it. If they are brought low, he does not see it. So after the grave, you don't see anything. You don't see them being honored, growing up. You know, if you died at a young age when your kids were younger, and you just longed to see them grow up and graduate maybe, or go on to get married themselves, you would miss all of that. There is none of that. That's what the text says. It says, if your sons are honored, you do not know it. If they're brought low, you do not know it. So you don't see the good, and you don't see the bad. I mean, you don't know if if they went off to battle someday and they died in battle. You don't know if there they were, not being honorable as well. And so the text is clear in Proverbs and in Job especially. This idea is that in the grave there is no consciousness. The plans and even the worship cease. And if our worship ceases at the grave, we need to worship all we can now, and because there's going to be a pause, and the next thing we know, we're going to see the one we've been worshiping. So in other words, with all your breath, worship God now, because in death there is no worship. And if there is no worship in death, then there's nobody up in heaven right now worshiping God except for those select few I've been talking to you about. So death is a state of perfect rest or sleep until the resurrection, when Christ wakes you up and says, now all the sorrow is over. In Revelation, he wipes away every tear. In Psalm 115, it says, the dead do not praise the Lord, nor any who go down into silence. So we don't even, if we pass away and we're not somehow like Moses, for instance, resurrected as a piece of first fruits, or an indication that God has power over the grave, in Jude you find that account, then we wait. Or if we didn't walk into heaven like Enoch did, then we don't praise the Lord anymore. We pause until it's time to praise the Lord again. Colossians says, for you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. So when we accept Jesus, we die, spiritually speaking. We're dead. Murray doesn't exist anymore when I accept Jesus. My life is now hidden with Christ in God. It's the same type of thing with death. When it comes to physical death, I'm in Christ. He holds the keys of my tomb. He's going to unlock it when he says so, just like with Lazarus. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. And so when does it take place? You know, if you look here, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ. Now we find when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. This is the concept that Paul teaches over and over again. When Christ appears, you'll hear the sound of the trumpet. He has specific indicators as to when this takes place. And it's important because in Revelation, there are demon spirits performing miracles and witchcraft that really are going to deceive many people. In fact, they already are deceiving many people. So the Bible teaches death is like a sleep. The believer who dies is as secure as if he were sleeping in Christ's arms, the arms of his friend. And every time one of my kids goes to sleep in my arms, they're trusting me to take care of them. They're trusting me that if anything were to happen while they were asleep, that I would take care of it. That's exactly what the Bible pictures God as, a loving father who literally, no matter how horrible or good the death was, I don't know how good death can be, really. I mean, you think of any particular death, there's the separation, there's the pain, there's all of that. God holds that loved one in his arms. And so he holds them there until the resurrection day. That's where we get pictures like this in the Bible. And so now I have the question then, if the Bible doesn't teach an immortal soul, that immortality comes from God, where did this idea come from? Well, you wouldn't be surprised, would you? Pagan Greek philosophy goes back actually all the way to the serpent in Genesis 3, like I mentioned before. But pagan Greek philosophy is what led up to the time of Christ. It goes before that to Babylonian cultures, and you have if you were to go work yourself backwards, pagan converts to Christianity, back to Hellenistic Jews, back to Greek culture, back to Babylon, all the way back to the serpent, if you worked your way backwards. If you worked your way forwards, it would go from the time of the serpent who said, yeah, you're not going to die, and it continues on from there. this idea of somehow we have immortality of ourselves. If we have it in ourselves, like I'm going to ask the question over and over again, then why did Jesus come? That's the biggest argument against immortality of the soul, because if we had it in and of ourselves, we wouldn't need Christ. So we find the serpent tells us, you surely will not die. Babylon and other cultures adopted similar viewpoints of life after death. If you go to, I'm not saying you need to do this, but I had to do it for a report. I went and I found the Egyptian Book of the Dead for a report, and I was reading through some of these afterlife experiences that they describe in this Book of the Dead, and it's pretty clear that they believe it's right after. There's that's why you're putting all these things in the tombs and all of that. There's an immediate transfer that takes place. There's something that you have to do to secure it, of course, but those religions all taught this immediacy. Somehow you could attain it right away. In the Greek culture, there was a lot of different viewpoints as far as the way of explaining it, but the biggest idea was somehow you could access it through knowledge, especially among the Greeks. And then the Hellenistic Jews, of course, got into some of that. And then we know that in the pagan Christian tradition that kind of developed after the time of the first century church, the converts still believe some of this. That's why it says in the Anti-Nicene Fathers, Justin Martyr, which I don't agree with everything he said, but it's interesting this part. If you have fallen in with some who are called Christians, but who do not admit this, it's talking about the truth of the resurrection, not right away, but at the end, and venture to blaspheme the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob, who say there is no resurrection of the dead, and that their souls, when they die, are taken to heaven, meaning right away, do not imagine that they are Christians. That's how strong he came across. If they don't believe in a resurrection day, they've taken even the concept of resurrection out of the Bible with the immortality of the soul. And he says, don't even imagine that they're Christians. Now, I wouldn't necessarily go that strong. He has some really strong words in his writings, and some of them are anti-Semitic as well. So as I look at this, though, I will agree with him that if we don't believe in a resurrection of the dead, somehow we just go right away, then there is no resurrection concept. Unless we say somehow Jesus keeps track of everybody and just individually says, arise, right when they die, right? Immediately. But usually people don't teach that. So we find this concept of souls going right away after death was forbidden in Israel. In Deuteronomy, it's pretty clear. You don't even talk. It's an abomination to talk to the dead because they saw a resurrection day coming. And even down in this time frame here, there is still that viewpoint. And it's become a huge religion. Spiritism is what I call it. You find John Edwards, J.Z. Knight, especially you find John Edwards in his very expensive seminars. One time I was just trying to get a picture of the guy, and I went to his website, and it just totally creeped me out just to get a picture of the guy for a seminar. The cost involved with his seminars in Nevada and other places. J.Z. Knight, this idea of Ramtha, somehow she's reincarnated this idea of Ramtha, this warrior takes control of her. And unfortunately for her, Ramtha says that he knows what she knows. But then when they ask him what Safeway is, he says, well, what is Safeway? You know, so it's just this whole strange, I know what you know and I know everything type of person coming back from the grave and trying to guide you and be your spirit counselor and all of this. And yet you ask him what Safeway is and he pretends like he doesn't know what it is. So it's, I know what you know, but I don't know anything. So it's a lot of, if you read some of these guys' statements, it's really strange like that, and it seems deceptive, very deceptive. And so my question is, who are they talking to on the other side? Well, we know if the Bible teaches that you have a resurrection day coming, waiting for the voice of Jesus like Lazarus did, you're asleep until then, you have no thoughts until then, your worship fades, your loved ones continue living on. You don't see good or bad. Then your loved ones are not talking to you beyond the grave. They're talking to someone who wants to suck them into some kind of deception. And I can think of no one else more who would want to do that than the devil, who uses these false ideas about death to deceive us. And I can tell you this from having done this for, there's some years where I was doing three or four of these meetings, and as I was doing them, you come across people who will accept the experience over what the Bible says. It's pretty discouraging to hear that. I mean, here you are, you've studied all these beautiful teachings, you come down to like a final weekend like this, and you present something like this, and now all of a sudden, they walk away from everything. because the loved one tells them, you don't need to study anymore. Just put that away. We don't need to study anymore. If someone told me that when I was baptized years ago, I wouldn't even be standing here. I'd just be somehow some pew warmer somewhere, and I probably would be out of the church altogether. I don't need to study anymore. So that's why Isaiah says, to the law and to the testimony in Isaiah 8:20, if it speaks not according to this word, there is no light in them. It's best for us to choose the Bible over our experiences, especially when our experiences are conflicting with the Bible. So that's what I'm choosing to believe. And so Jesus taught through the story of Lazarus that death was asleep until the voice of Jesus. In Corinthians it says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, that's the idea of death, but we will be changed. When? In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. That's the resurrection day. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. So I draw the conclusion from this, that death is an unconscious state or asleep until Jesus comes. You've got this beautiful, glorious trumpet experience that's taking place. We're all there. We're going to rise up with them. And so what about then that thief on the cross? Because some people always bring that one up. And as I look at the thief on the cross, humanly speaking, was it a very hopeful day for that guy? No. If you look at the human experience that he was going through, it was a discouraging day. I mean, he goes from, both of them were actually going after Christ for a little while, but then eventually he recognizes something in Jesus, that this is somebody that can save him. And so it goes from being a dismal day, facing death, really, literally just slowly killing, you know, dying off on the cross, you're going to be over there for a period of time, and eventually just suffocate. You go from that to then gaining hope from the person beside you. So the whole point of the thief on the cross is the hope that he experienced that day, and we know clearly that Jesus did not go to paradise that day. He said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Who are you seeking? She is supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned to him and said, Rabboni, which is to say teacher. She recognizes this is him. And what does she do? She begins to hold on to him. He says, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending. Present tense. He's getting ready to do it. Right there. To my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. And so what day was that? We know he dies here. He's resting in the tomb here. We all know what this one stands for. There he is over there. We call it Easter Sunday. And so we find that is when he ascends to heaven, but he died over here on this day. So just with this alone, we should have enough logic to say he did not give the promise to him that very day he's going to be with him in paradise, because he did not ascend to the Father until that Sunday after. So what was he saying? You all hear it. All depends on the punctuation, right? It really does. I mean, Jesus said to him, assuredly I say to you, and look, there's the comma right there. I've made it yellow for that reason. Today you'll be with me in paradise. So it could be, surely I'm telling you, today you'll be with me in paradise, right now, right? That's how some people translate it. Or, assuredly I say to you, I'm telling you right now, today, when it doesn't look real bright, right, you'll be with me in paradise. Which one would validate the experience of Jesus? We know this one would, but how do we know? I don't usually do this very often, but I have a Bible Works program, and they have pictures of all the Greek texts, the scrolls, the fragments and stuff that they have on record. And I want you to see the difficulty, if we were to go back to the scrolls, we would have in translating this, okay? Because there's no commas or punctuations in the original, and you're going to see this, I'm going to make this real big for you. So where would I put the comma at? You know, so here's our little text right over here. So you can imagine you've got this scroll in front of you. And yeah, you don't have the Hebrew problem of left to right. You can still read right to left. Excuse me, you can still read left to right instead of right to left like Hebrew. But as you get down there, this little text right here we're looking at is part of a huge part of the fragment there. So where is our passage? It's right over there in the red. I'll make it bigger for you. And if you don't know Greek, you don't know where it's at, but it's right here. And as you can see in the Greek, all caps, no commas, no punctuations. Sometimes translators have a difficulty in some of these things. And it's not until later on that we added it. For instance, over here, this is one Greek manuscript. And you can see they added the comma right there, right? And I say to you, okay, truly, excuse me, and he said to him, truly I say to you, and this is the word they use for day. They're saying, well, it's hey mera, but it's actually different than the word day. We'll come to that in a minute. And they say, this is the word today. Today with you, okay, in paradise. There's paradise right there. So as I look at that word today, I thought to myself, there's got to be something different because it looks different than the original lexical form that I learned. And as I look at that form, it's actually something that means considering or concerning what has happened today. It's a little different than just the pure lexical form. So concerning what has happened today, you will be with me in paradise. That's how I could literally translate it. So what do I go with? You know, there's no commas here. This guy came along later, put a comma there. So what am I going to do? Well, since I know paradise, by the way, it doesn't say kingdom, you'll be with me in the kingdom. It says actually you'll be with me in paradise, not kingdom. And so we know that he didn't go to paradise or the throne of God that day. So we have to go with the one that says the comma is going to be somewhere down over here after the word today. So I'm saying to you, concerning the things, you could even go like this, concerning the things that have happened today, dismal, not very good. I don't look like a king, do I? You'll be with me in paradise. And it would make more sense because you're dealing with breathing statements, short, right? And so you wouldn't get a huge, long sentence anyway. So Jesus dies that day. The soldier comes and pierces his side to make sure. Pilate was surprised. They expected them to last longer than that. He dies that day, and they come and get his body, but he'd already died. So he asks the centurion if Jesus had already died, and of course the centurion tells him yes. And we find, where does Jesus go? He goes into the tomb that day, and he goes into paradise, which you find in Revelation 2:7. Paradise is where the tree of life is, it's where the throne of God is, and we know that he doesn't go there until he says he goes there, and he says, I have not yet ascended to my Father on Sunday. So if we just use the way Jesus is talking in here, and then go look at the Greek, you find it's pretty clear direction. Concerning the things that have happened today, it may not look like much. Even though I'm in the tomb, trust me, you'll be with me in paradise. So he doesn't go that day. He's placed in the tomb. He comes back to life. He tells Mary he has not yet ascended. He does not go straight to heaven, neither do we. But later, though, he does conquer death. And that brings up the whole other story of the other Lazarus. The story of Lazarus, we find, was a clear-cut example of life after death. You wait until the voice of Jesus. We find no recollection of heaven or hell from Lazarus. It's just he comes forth with the voice of Jesus. But what about that other story of Lazarus, the rich man and Lazarus? This is interesting. In Luke 16, the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, underline it because that's a key phrase, and you're going to find that's the main problem that he's going to address here in this text. Lovers of money who won't listen to him. They were listening to all these things, and they were scoffing at Jesus. And he said to them, you are those who justify yourselves in the sight of men, but God knows your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is detestable in the sight of God. You may be rich, you may have money, you may have seats and prestige, but that doesn't mean anything. God knows your heart. So Jesus is trying to rebuke them and go after them a little bit. So who's his audience? Pharisees, okay? Teachers of the law. Some of them were rabbis. So we find now there was a certain, he tells this parable in the context of who he's talking to. He's talking to teachers of the law. He's talking to Pharisees who are lovers of money. Now there was a certain rich man, so that's where he takes them from. He takes them from where they're at. He's speaking to them directly. So it should not surprise us then that he uses a story that I'm going to show you was actually in circulation at the time. It's not saying the story in and of itself is true, but it's using something that they would be familiar with and taking them from that point to where he wants them to be. And so now there was a certain rich man, and he habitually dressed in purple and fine linen, gaily living in splendor every day. And a certain poor man named Lazarus was laid at the gate, covered with sores, longing to be fed with the crumbs which were falling from the rich man's table. Besides, even the dogs were coming and licking his sores. Now it came about that the poor man died, and he was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom. So it appears that he's using a story that is showing life right after death. But once again, remember who he's talking to here. Lovers of money, Pharisees, some of them are steeped in Hellenistic tradition. In other words, they believe in life after death immediately, whereas Jesus taught differently, and so did the apostles. So he carries this person to Abraham's bosom, and in Hades he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and saw Abraham far away and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried out and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I am in agony in this flame. But Abraham said, Child, remember that during your life, isn't that the point, you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus bad things. But now he is being comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you there is a great chasm fixed, in order that those who wish to come over from here to you may not be able to. That should correct a lot of life after death weird views. There is no coming over. And that none may cross over from here, from there to us. And he said, Then I beg you, Father, that you send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Do you ever find Jesus saying that God will send Lazarus he's departed, he's dead. Is he going to go back and talk to people? No, you don't find that teaching in here. But Abraham said, They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. But he said, No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to them, If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded if someone rises from the dead. What's the main point here? Is it all the details? Is it the familiar story? Or is it the punchline at the end? This is a rabbinical teacher, Jesus. You find the rabbis typically, a lot of them would have sometimes a main point at the beginning or in the middle, but Jesus often, the law of end stress, right at the end, he hits them with it. And in here, he tells you, here's the main point. You're not going to be persuaded even if someone rises from the dead. You need to make the decision now. Now is the time. So the problem I have with taking it literally is, in the Greek itself, the word bosom, kolpos, that's the front part of your body, and between the arms here, it can even stretch down to your stomach area, your pouch area. So this is the area we're talking about when we're looking at the Greek language here. And so we find Abraham's bosom, people being gathered into there. We can't take it literally. That's why some scholars, even the ones who believe in immediate life after death, say, well, he's just coming to Abraham's side. But in the text, it's different. You're in Abraham's bosom. So it's a figure of speech. We know that's a figure of speech. And those in the flames can see those who are in paradise and are within shouting distance. Even though there's supposedly there's no coming back, there's this shouting distance going on in this one particular case. I don't know if we would want to believe that in eternity, those who are burning forever and ever and receiving eternal life to keep burning forever and ever, which they shouldn't receive because the wages of sin is death, are talking to us in agony. It would totally take away life for us as we know it. And that's what the devil really would want. And those who suffer in flames, we want to believe that they suffer physically. A lot of people do not teach that. Most people do not teach that. They believe they're suffering spiritually somehow. They're not there in body and spirit. They're just departed spirits suffering there. Now we have a description here in this text where it's physical. They could actually be quenched with water on their tongue. So I don't think we want to consider this literally. So what was the main point? It was told to those who were selfish and pursued wealth in this life that there would be no crossing over. Once their decisions were made, that was it. And Jesus then hits the main point. They would not even believe, even if someone were to rise from the dead. Their destinies were being fixed as they were rejecting Jesus. And notice it says, even if someone were to rise from the dead. Even in Jesus' own teaching, right at the end there, the last part of the parable, how do people come back from the dead? They rise from the dead. So as you look at this, Jesus' story was used, he was using a story that was meant to bring shock value, and his clear teaching is right here. If someone were to even rise from the dead, they would not believe. And that's exactly what happens. Lazarus rises from the dead. Jesus, Lazarus rises from the dead. So you have that law of interest. Otherwise, later on, you would be contradicting Jesus' own words. A time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. So Jesus would be contradicting himself if he went along with the stories of that day. Robert Stein, in the Introduction to Parables of Jesus, page 85, says, Irenaeus even recounts a rabbinic story of a rich tax collector, Barmajan, who was received into heaven, like right away, because he once made a banquet for the city councilors, and when they refused to attend, he invited the poor to eat the food that was not, so that the food would not be wasted. So we have a story in the rabbinical teaching records that were later written down of a rich tax collector who was received right away into heaven after his death because he showed kindness to a poor man. It's almost the same story, but in reverse. And so what we find is, as we look at the rabbinical teachings, there is evidence of stories like this. So I'm saying, I believe that we're looking at the words of Jesus at the end of the parable, and the rest is he's using a familiar story, leading them along, and then hitting them with the main point at the end. And some say, well, what about absent from the body, present with the Lord? The manuscript will talk more about that, but in essence, Paul was longing for a change. And he knew that that would only take place if he was to die and see Jesus at the resurrection. So the way that we conquer death is clear in Paul's writings, 1 Corinthians 15. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed and holy, in Revelation it says, is he who has part in the first resurrection, which we'll talk about tomorrow. Over such, the second death has no power. So Jesus has given us victory over death. That's why John 3:16 says, God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him, will not perish, but have everlasting life. The reverse is also true. If we choose not to believe in him, we will perish, and we will not have eternal life. So John 3:16 itself answers the idea of life after death by saying, if you believe, you won't perish and you'll have everlasting life. If you don't believe, you will perish and you won't have everlasting life. There's a movie called Hell and Mr. Fudge. You'll find it's very fascinating. This guy goes through and he comes to the same conclusion I do after looking at all the evidence and says, you know, death is an unconscious sleep. And that was a reverend of a different, a pastor of a different church. And so 1 Thessalonians 4:16 tells us when it takes place, just by way of review, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of our archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. So if we are still alive, we will see our loved ones coming out of the grave, going up into the air, and then we will join them in the air. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. And that's why Paul says he will bring with Jesus those who are saved, because it's at this point all of those who are with Jesus are together and going up in the clouds with him. So at his voice, the graves are opened. That means his words are the key. That means we need to be studying his words, spending time with his voice, listening to what he has to say to us, because that's the sweet voice that not only walks us through Revelation and calls us out of spiritual Babylon, but at the end, he calls us out of the grave itself. He says, I have those keys. Do you trust me? Do you trust me and my words to lead you all the way? And so we sleep until the last trumpet and the voice of Jesus wakens us. That's where I want to be. That's why he says, I have the keys of Hades and of death. Trust in Jesus. Enoch, Elijah, Moses, 24 elders, they all trusted in life after death the way we've taught about it here tonight. Hell, we're going to talk more about that tomorrow, but basically we rise when he calls our names and we will be with him forever. And so if you have any questions, feel free to write down in the question basket out there. I'd be happy to sit there with you and visit with you about them. I'm going to invite Marla to come up here and lead us in a song as we close off tonight. And this is a beautiful song, a song of hope, the gleams of the golden morning. Thank you, Marla.
Jesus To rescue his purified, faithful bride, prepared to meet her groom. Then the dead in Christ will arise to glory, then the living will follow too. Oh, the midnight hour is fast approaching, that will burst the tomb. The testing time is right now upon us before the trumpet sounds. We will carry crosses of separation, then receive the crowns. And the dead in Christ will arise to glory, then the living will follow too. Oh, the midnight hour is fast approaching, that will burst the tomb. Attended by all the shining angels down the flaming sky, our Lord will come and will take his people where they will not die. For the dead in Christ will arise to glory, then the living will follow too. Oh, the midnight hour is fast approaching, that will burst the tomb. There are loved ones who have long been parted, will meet in the air and travel together to heaven's mansions, which have been prepared. Yes, the midnight hour is fast approaching, that will burst the tomb. Oh, the midnight hour is fast approaching, that will burst the tomb.
Father in heaven, we want to trust our Savior Jesus Christ with our own hearts, with our loved ones who have passed, for we don't want to neglect those memories. We look forward to the reunion day. So Lord, we place them in your hands as well. And we place ourselves in your hands so you can help us to share your message of life with those around us until we see you face to face on that beautiful morning. Guide us until that end, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.